Hi, everybody. This is Alan Arnette with another podcast on the blog on alanarnette.com. Today, we're talking about Everest 2021. It's April the 20th, Tuesday, April 20th, 2021. Something happened today on Everest that's going to stop action for about 5 days. It's a pretty normal occurrence. There's an avalanche that came off the west shoulder of Everest and hit the icefall directly and knocked out part of the route. The icefall doctors are estimating it's going to take 5 days to repair the route or reroute around all of the debris. So it's a pretty serious avalanche that occurred. This is not unusual. These avalanches occur all the time. Occasionally they are bigger than other times and cause problems like this. But thankfully it appears that nobody was in the icefall in that area when it hit, unlike in 2014 when 14 Sherpas were killed by a similar avalanche off of that west shoulder. So I've got a video of it that was taken by the broad boy. I can't pronounce his name properly. Shirozi Kashif, and also the Karakoram Club. So thanks to them for passing along that video of the avalanche. Well, the other thing that's going on is that the permits are just exploding. It is just almost getting up to the point of the 382 back in 2019. Right now, there's 371 permits issued to foreigners across 39 teams. That's a lot of teams. That's a higher level of teams than what we normally see. Normally it's in the low 30s, something like that. So this year there's a lot of pent up demand because of no climbing in 2020. Also, there's some bargains that were being offered by mainly the Nepali companies. Almost all the Western outfits that went have full teams, 10, 20, in some cases, 25 to 30 people, like with IMG and climbing the seven summits. So as always, a lot of interest in Mount Everest, and people are coming to try to get to the top of the world as usual. You know, so I'm going to kind of take a little bit of a break here and think about the bigger picture. And I want to talk about the storyline for spring 2021. And the storyline is that, honestly, there is no storyline. You know, it's pretty much of a normal season. I mean, yeah, we're approaching the record number of permits, and that's probably the storyline if there is one. But, you know, the weather has been pretty normal, albeit with the avalanche. We've had, you know, cold temperatures, which is pretty normal for April. And there's been days on and again, off again of snow, which again is pretty normal because this is, you know, basically the end of winter as we approach spring. The fixed ropes are up to the yellow band, which is really good news. This delay is going to slow that down a little bit, but it won't surprise me to see the Sherpas find a way to get around that blockage while the icefall doctors are working on it and get the ropes up to the South Col at a minimum, and who knows, maybe even the summit. I fully expect the ropes to be to the summit by the 1st of May. In terms of acclimatization, you know, again, from a storyline perspective, things are pretty much right on schedule. A lot of teams have already done at least one virtual rotation, if you will, by going up Lobachay or going on other peaks to 20,000 feet. So they really are looking at doing two primary rotations to Camp 2, and then back again, maybe to Camp 3 to tag it or hopefully spend the night. Those people climbing without oxygen, without supplemental oxygen, typically they like to get to the South Col, at least tag it 8,000 meters and then come back down. So they've got to work their bodies a lot harder in order to get prepared to climb Everest without supplemental oxygen. So, you know, and lastly, as far as storylines go, COVID, you know, we've got one report of a climber that that came down ill as he was approaching base camp. He was in base camp and helicoptered back to Kathmandu, where he tested positive, and he had a second test about a week later, and he tested positive again. So it appears that he has COVID, but is still unclear. It's not 100% certain, you know, according to his own personal reports. But, you know, it exists. COVID is continuing to spike throughout Nepal. Death rates are continuing to be relatively low because of the young population throughout Nepal. So all in all, COVID is also not thus far, as far as we know, not being a major issue with respect to Everest and the climbing. So that's really the storylines right there. Another story that's happening is that Kilian Jornet, famous trail runner, he claimed that he summited Everest twice in a week back in 2017. A couple of weeks ago, I reported that he was going to go back and go up to the West Ridge, but then my sources kind of dried up on that. But now it looks like there's another report that came out that says now he's going to do the Everest Lhotse Traverse. And apparently he wants to do it in the true traverse, which is to go directly from the summit of Everest down to the South Col and then back up Lhotse without going down to the Lhotse High Camp or Camp 3 or Camp 2. In my mind, that's a linked climb. That's not a true traverse. And there are people claiming that they're going to do it. They're going to do a traverse by that method. And, that's just doesn't hold water in my book. So again, the number of permits out there, Everest at 371 across 39 teams, Lhotse 104 people, which is astonishing for Lhotse, given that the record ever was in the low 80s, like 82 people. So it's going to be crowded this year. You know, once everything kind of settles down, the ropes get in, everybody's acclimatized, and they start going up towards the middle of May, it's going to be crowded. So really, we're hoping that the winds will hold off and give the time for all these teams to spread out over at least a week, if not 10 days, preferably, so that we don't have literally hundreds upon hundreds of people going up on the same day. You know, over on Annapurna, just talk about that briefly. It's kind of a mixed bag in my mind. Yes, we had record summits, and congratulations to all the female climbers, a record number of female climbers on Annapurna this year. In total, close to 70 people summited. But the fly in the ointment here is that for, you know, some of those people, they were on that first wave and they ran out of fixed rope because they didn't anticipate the conditions. So they only brought enough rope to fix the normal part of the route, but they found they had to fix other parts of the route they normally don't do. Therefore, they ran out of fixed rope. Also, the weather started closing in. So they all came back down to the high camp where there wasn't enough tents. They were using up their precious supplemental oxygen. Almost everybody was climbing with supplemental oxygen. It was very much of an Everest-style siege climb on Annapurna, which is highly, highly unusual. This is a side impact of commercialization where people could simply pay, have a dedicated team of Sherpas fix the ropes, carry all their gear, and go up and claim the summit. It's never been done on Annapurna. And to make matters worse, once they came back down, once they ran out of rope, they called for a helicopter from Kathmandu to come in and resupply with oxygen, food, fuel, and of course, more rope. And so then the next day, they all went up and they summited. But then coming down, one person got tired at Camp 3, and he called for a helicopter to come pick him up because he was worried he was going to exert all of his energy going down because he wants to go to Dalagari next. And then three Russian climbers went missing between Camp 4 and Camp 3. There was a search done by the Sherpas for them. They found them. They used what's called a long line technique to get them back down to base camp or to Kathmandu. There was a lot of aviation assistance that went on Annapurna this year. And my fear is that it's a slippery slope, that if you can just resupply the high camps, then why bother to use Sherpas to carry all the stuff up to a high camp? Why don't you just go on Everest? Eventually they're going to be able to get those helicopters up to the South Col. So why don't you just carry all the gear up to the South Col by helicopter? And then people can just go up there and they can do it in 2 weeks like they did on Annapurna. I know this sounds crazy, but we're seeing last year in 2019, a female climber from the U.S. did Everest from home to home in 2 weeks. She used pre-acclimatization techniques. There was no helicopter, so certainly apples and oranges. But this type of advances in using technology, I think it begins to undermine the very integrity of the sport. And so I would really encourage operators to give it a second thought about using these this technology to help them accomplish their objectives and to get more paying clients. Okay, enough of my soapbox here. The big mountain coming up next is Dalagari. In addition to the Everest scene, there's already people there. Of course, Carlos Soria, at 82 years old, he's over on Dalagari. This is his 12th time. You heard me right. 12th time to attempt Dalagari. And man, I hope he gets it. Because if he does, now all he'll have left is Shishapangma to, in order for him to tick off all 14 of the 8,000 meter mountains at age 82. He didn't start climbing till he was 70, just a young man. Absolutely love Carlos and wish him the absolute best. There's another Slovak-Romanian team, Peter Hammer, Marius Gain, and Horia, I can't even pronounce Horia's last name, Colablanca, that they're on the West Ridge. They've made a lot of progress. They've fixed the most difficult part of that route. And if they can get the West Ridge of Dalagari, that'll be a first. Actually, it's the Northwest Ridge, to be technically accurate. And so that'll be a first. So good luck to them. You know, those guys from that part of the world just always just knock it out of the park and just do great things. Okay, so that's it. That's a quick update here on, again, Tuesday, April the 20th. Best of luck to everybody, and especially those Icefall doctors who work so hard to get the route in and keep it up. And so everybody sitting at base camp, you know, take a few active rest days, go over to Pumori Camp 1 and 2. Don't go back down to Gorik Shep and to all the tea houses, even though there's not a lot of trekkers. Just don't get yourself exposed to potentially contaminants outside of base camp. Stay within your bubbles and kind of follow your protocol. But hopefully everything will go well, and we'll have the route in to the north face, or to the south, to the summit here soon, and the rotations can pick back up. Okay, that's it for now. Climb on. This is Alan, and remember, memories are everything.